When other European explorers reached America, they were equally amazed. People throughout Europe read exciting travelers' accounts, like Amerigo Vespucci's 1504 bestseller, Mundus Novus, which actually coined the term New World and made it very clear to anyone who might still be confused that these lands were not Asia, but were a previously unknown continent. Like Columbus, explorers carried back to Europe not only eyewitness accounts of wealthy civilizations and legends of cities of gold, but samples of native plants and animals and captive natives. Columbus returned to the Caribbean in 1493 with 17 ships, 1,200 men, and according to his diaries, seeds and cuttings for the planting of wheat, chickpeas, melons, onions, radishes, salad greens, grapevines, sugarcane, and fruit stones for the founding of orchard. Other old world crops that thrived in the Americas included coffee and bananas, which were brought from the Canary Islands in 1516. And it's very important that the Spanish brought sugar. They had introduced sugar cultivation to the Canary Islands in the early 15th century. So it naturally made sense for them to transplant canes to this new tropical paradise that their explorers had discovered across the Atlantic. Cattle were delivered to Spanish conquistadors in Mexico in 1521. By 1614, according to one of the conquistador chronicles, the residents of Santiago, which is in Chile, over 4,000 miles away, possessed 39,250 head of cattle, as well as flocks totaling 623,825 sheep, which had also been introduced by the Spanish. According to local traditions, when Pizarro first invaded Peru in the late 1520s, he crossed the Andes with only 80 fighting men and 40 horses, but with over 2,000 pigs. And this isn't the only mention of conquistador armies traveling with thousands of pigs. It must have been an incredible sight. Most of the really significant Eurasian species brought to the Americas by European explorers and colonists were introduced by the Spanish in the early 1500s, long before North American settlement ever began. Even species like the wild horses of the American West that would transform Plains Indian culture in the 18th and the early 19th centuries were actually descendants of escapees of the herds of the conquistadors. The Americas had very few large mammal species, and most of them could not be domesticated. Domestication is only successful with social animals that will accept a human as the leader of their herd or their pack. Nearly all species that humans have successfully domesticated, which are now the familiar residents of the modern farmyard, originated in Europe and Asia. These include goats, sheep, cows, horses, pigs, and chickens. Eurasians probably began domesticating these animals about 10,000 years ago, maybe as early as 15,000 years ago. Animal husbandry, in other words, began just a bit too late for the Beringians to bring domesticated animals along with them into North America. And in any case, the Beringians were probably hunters and gatherers, not farmers and pastoralists. You may be wondering why the first century of colonization in the Americas was dominated by the Spanish and Portuguese. Partly it's because Spain and Portugal had just finished their Reconquista and had an 8-century-long tradition of warfare and conquest, fighting the Muslim Moors. The Portuguese also had a maritime tradition, which was how Columbus learned his trade. But the two Catholic nations also had a papal charter. The Spanish and the Portuguese were granted a license by the Pope under the 1494 Treaty of Tordesillas, which awarded all of the territory east of the 47th meridian to Portugal and everything west of it to Spain. The Pope, Alexander VI, who made this deal, was a Spaniard named Rodrigo Borgia. His reign was known for nepotism and corruption, and he was, of course, the father of the famous Italian political family, the Borgias, who are well known for poisoning their enemies. The Portuguese got the East because they had already been establishing colonies on the east and west coasts of Africa. The Spanish got the unknown West, which turned out to be bigger than anyone had ever expected. No one else actually got anything. And this type of corruption at the Vatican helped to motivate reformers like Martin Luther toward what would ultimately become the Protestant Reformation. Now, on the other side of the world, in China, the economy was thriving under the Ming Dynasty. Farmers were producing rice using the irrigation system that had been repaired by the empire after the famines, and they were planting wheat and other grains in drier western provinces. The abundance of food sparked a population boom, and the newly repaired Grand Canal allowed goods to flow freely in a domestic market that became so big that China didn't really need to concern itself with international trade. Since the Chinese didn't depend on trade with outsiders, they could afford to be very picky. Europeans soon found that China was willing to sell them its surplus goods and its silks and its porcelain, but only for silver, which was the basis of China's currency. In the 1500s, China had got most of its silver from Japan. In the 1560s, however, China found a new source when the Spanish took over the Philippine Islands and began sending annual treasure fleets across the Pacific from their new American colonies. For the next 200 years, at least a third of all the silver mined in the Americas found its way to China. The Indian Ocean trade routes and the Silk Road also thrived. Malacca, which was a city-state strategically located on the strait connecting the Indian Ocean with the South China Sea, became a very important trading hub. The Portuguese became the masters at controlling these trading hubs, like Malacca and Aden in the Red Sea and Hormuz in the Persian Gulf, sometimes resorting to terrorism to assert their dominance. Portugal also dominated ports like Goa and Calicut in India, and Macau in China, and really controlled the most active sea lanes of the Indian Ocean. Portuguese success partially rested on the fact that they didn't stop the flow of trade, they only protected it for a fee and profited on all of it. Now, before I move on, a couple more questions for discussion. First, what caused the Europeans to get so excited about these newly discovered lands across the Atlantic? And then secondly, why did the Spanish and Portuguese dominate this early colonization in the first century or so of European knowledge of the New World?